Please be seated. It's a great honor to welcome all of you in this room where we are still very few, colleagues, students, friends of Wageningen University and Research, but above all, a special welcome also to our online guests. More than 2,200 people have registered. And a special welcome needs to be extended to our guests, our special guests, that is, the Mayor of Wageningen, the President of the Royal Academy of Arts and Sciences, and the members of our Supervisory Committee. This is indeed not a normal opening of the academic year, but it will be worth your while, I promise that. It will be different, but still. The theme today is crossing boundaries, and it's really about what art and science have in common. I'm not talking so much about how science can inspire artists, beautiful blurbs of microbia in all kinds of colors or the galaxies, nor about how scientists can be inspired by the breaking of the light in a painting. Now, I want to talk about something which is more fundamental. It's about ways of seeing, the way in which we explore the world. As a human species, we're unique, not so much unique in exploring our world, because every species does that, but in the way we extend our boundaries. We extend them not just in a concrete material sense, but also in an abstract sense. We have a capacity for abstraction that no other species has. And through that capacity, we push our boundaries out. We push, we connect, and we look at what is different. We try to find patterns. We try to find the unexpected. We try to find by looking. Looking, or observation in scientific jargon, is probably the most important thing we do. And we don't only look with our eyes, we look also really with our mind's eye. Perhaps you know the Italian minimalist painter Giorgio Morandi, the one who painted beautiful ceramic pots in very subtle colors. He once said, and I think he put that very well, he said, "You can travel the world and see many things, but see nothing. In order to gain understanding, it's not necessary to see a whole lot of things, but it is to concentrate, looking at what you really need to see." And that's really what art and sciences both are about trying to push these boundaries, trying to see the unseen, to look at the invisible. And by the way, this is very important for education, because perhaps the most important thing we can teach today is to look, to know how to look, to see the unexpected, to see patterns. Because all the rest, or nearly all the rest, you can find now on this wonderful thing called internet. But to know what you look for, and then use mathematical or artistic methods to explore it, that is really unique to science and to art. And that is still a scarce resource. It means, by the way, also that we should allow a certain polyphony, a numerous set of voices. It's not a matter of just one voice, one image, one horizon. It's that diversity in its abstract sense that I think also makes an academic institution what it is and what it should be. Now, who says boundaries says, of course, serendipity, because beyond the boundary lies our imagination, lies serendipity, this wonderful capacity that we have to see something which wasn't there before. And you know all the examples, of course, the discovery of X-rays, the discovery of the microwave, the discovery of penicillin, or even the discovery of that very simple, humble, little yellow glue sticky pad that you all have on your desks. All those were products of serendipity. But what makes it so special is that there was someone who did not discard a dirty Petri dish, who did not discard a glue that didn't seem functional, but someone who looked across the boundary and saw something new, saw a new application, a new set of meanings, a new understanding. And in that sense, art and sciences really are quite close together. But who says boundaries also says failures, of course. Because fail we do. Not every road to cross the boundary leads to something. Sometimes it is a dead end. Sometimes it leads to a discovery that's meaningless, or even a discovery that has a negative effect. So we should also have room, not just for crossing those boundaries, or for serendipity, or for the unplanned, but also for failures. Failures, coincidences, indeed, the unplanned. And there's a category of failures that I call masterful failures, failures that are necessary in order still to gain that understanding, that looking beyond the horizon. And that's why we should accept our failures. Unfortunately, in today's age, accepting failures, accepting this freedom of thinking, this freedom of looking, the room for serendipity is not very great. In fact, many of those who fund our research and our education see our institutions more and more as a kind of supermarket supply chain, where with €1 you get a result which immediately leads to innovation, to market access, to economic growth. And yes, of course, economic growth is extremely important, especially in countries where so many people are still so poor. But we must have room. We must have room for serendipity. We must have room for failures. We must have room for those things that are invisible. Art and science make the invisible visible, but they cannot dance to the whims of society. And I think this is a very important lesson to be drawn from the way we are organized today. We want output, but output is just not enough. Output is something that only comes with these moments of discovery, these moments of serendipity, these wrong roads that we go, these roundabout ways, these false horizons, all that must be somewhere visible in our system. Now, for today, I want to share two pieces of video. The first one I will show now, and it gives you an idea of what I mean by coincidence, chance, connection, and so on. It's a video about the work of, or documentary, I should say, about the work of Herman de Vries. Somebody, some of you may know, he's a very well-known artist. He represented the Netherlands at the Biennale in Venice not so long ago. But what many people do not know is that he started his career here at Wageningen, in the Institute then of Phytopathology. And he started looking at patterns of disease, patterns also of seed dissemination. And it's this idea of patterns that, and using the natural flow of things, that has come back in his work ever since. So here is Herman de Vries, filmed by his son in a piece of work which we have received courtesy the Schiedam Museum. It's part of a larger project called All/No Things, or Nothing. And this part is called Chance and Change. Please enjoy.
Dit zijn 1, 2 en 3 uur onder mijn appelboom. Toen ik me dus begon interesseren van gebeurtenissen in de natuur, in plaats van toevalsprogrammeringen, was een van de eerste dingen die we deed, een blad papier onder de appelboom leggen. En te kijken waar de blaadjes vallen. Dan had ik een natuurlijke toevalsverdeling. Dat heb ik hier gedaan, dat is de eerste serie die ik maakte. Maar tegelijk duikt het idee van chance and change op kans en verandering. Dit was rudimentair voor het eerst in mijn werk op deze wijze aanwezig. Je ziet het bijvoorbeeld ook terug in een fotoserie als een random sample of een visual chance is een Luang Prabang. Ik liep dus door een stadje Ik had Susanna liep naast me en zei me nu. En dan wist ik dat het weer een tijdpunt was. Dan stopte ik. En zei ze een getal. Dat was een richting. 90 graden was hier. 180 graden was hier. En zo kon ik ongeveer vinden in welke richting ik moet kijken. Ik liep verder. Ze zei 200. Stop, 200. Ik draaide me om. 180. Ongeveer daar. En ik nam een foto. En zo heb ik mijn kansenveld, mijn visuele kansen, bemonsterd. En zo zijn deze foto's dan het resultaat van wat ik als visuele kansen had. En dat was een ander gebruik van toeval, maar tegelijkertijd ook natuurlijk een steeds wisselend aspect van visuele mogelijkheden. En visuele mogelijkheden zijn ook altijd andere existentiële mogelijkheden. Ik heb ook in die tijd gelijk de stad Luang Prabang tentoongesteld. Dat was dus de complete tentoonstelling van het hele stadje Luang Prabang. Zodat ik eigenlijk via de tentoonstelling van Luang Prabang eigenlijk de hele wereld in mijn werk in betrok. Dat kan je ook eigenlijk terugvinden, theoretisch, in het beeld al wat daar staat. Daar komen we straks nog even op. En deze catalogus, die hier uit ontstaan is, is een incomplete catalogus. Want het is nooit mogelijk om een complete catalogus te maken. Een thema waar ik al in de 50 jaar mee bezig was, waren dan toevallige dingen, ook wel toevallig, hoewel ik niet aan toeval dacht, die ik zag, die ik vond. Het eerst was het op de plakkaatwanden van Parijs. Kleine stukje van plakkaatresten die over elkaar gebleven waren en een nieuw beeld opleverden. Deze kleine fragmenten nam ik mee en ik noem ze collage trouvée. Deze kleine collage trouvée, daar is niks aan veranderd, het is het stuk wat ik vond. Was op de hoek van Rue Saint-Séverin met de Rue Xavier Privas, 1954. Ik schreef dat 6 weken lang, 2 tot 8 uur per dag. En het werkte als een mantra. Ook als ik het niet beschreef, was er altijd het begrip van all, all. Van de compleetheid, van alles te samenhoren in mijn kop. All, 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 all. Oh, 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 oh.
I hope you understood what I meant by coincidence patterns and seeking the coincidences. What I should add is that we also have a piece of his art on our campus. And you may not have seen it. It's at the west entrance of Orion, and I hope you enjoy it next time when you come on campus. I'm now joined on the podium by 3 of our guests. And as you know, we always have this tradition of having other people discussing our work. But first of all, and I think I'm going to stand up again because this doesn't feel right for that side of the room, I'm going to make a special announcement. An announcement that we are very, very proud of. An announcement that is of great importance, we feel, for the future. And that has to do with the most prominent example of serendipity in the last decade. That is the discovery of CRISPR-Cas. CRISPR-Cas, as you know, is a gene editing technique, and it's actually based on work done on some very esoteric bacteria and archaea, ones actually that probably evolved already 2 billion years ago. And their defense system to the intrusion of viral genetic material actually made us discover something very special, a way to really do precision editing of genes. That discovery was not just a discovery in the United States or in Europe elsewhere. It's something that's very much based on the work by John van der Oost, who is sitting here next to me. And we, as Wageningen University and Research, actually hold a number of 5 patents, intellectual property rights, on this technique. And what we have decided today, on the eve of the UN conference on food systems, is to really give these in the form of licenses for non-profit applications to organizations that want to further the goal of fighting hunger and providing people with an adequate diet. This is a major step, which we consider an integral part of the way we look at open science. That is, to give access to our intellectual property for specific purposes, and also in a context of helping and exchanging ideas with people who want to further these same goals. As far as we know, this is unique in the world. It will be hopefully also picked up by other organizations. Tonight, a piece in Nature will actually highlight this. It's the first time, to our knowledge, as I said, that the CRISPR-Cas, or that in the field of CRISPR-Cas, I should say, intellectual property is given for free. We do this more specifically for something called our ThermoCas9. We will get John to explain to you what this is. But this is an announcement of major importance, I feel, and very appropriate for Wageningen. We feel this is the right thing to do. This is about furthering our goal of science and education for impact. So here I have with me John van der Oost, who will give the floor in a minute, Nikita Saif and Max Kardum, who will, from their different perspectives, and will show you their perspectives in a minute, comment on this gesture and also on the whole implication of it. Now, John, you are one of the co-discoverers of this technique, and perhaps it's good you present yourself and also explain what the importance is of this gesture.
Okay, well, let me start by saying that the theme of this or of today's event is very close to my heart, and especially the term serendipity is very important in this, also in the discovery of CRISPR. So we played indeed an important role. So me together with my group here in Wageningen, because we were just curious. We were curious because we heard about the existence or the hypothesis that maybe also bacteria could have an adaptive immune system. Well, this was unheard of. We were intrigued by that possibility, so we started studying this. And we did so with money of NWO. And basically, I obtained that money. It was a Vici grant. I obtained that money to study something completely different. But then I decided, okay, this is too good to be true, so let's go for it. We were so curious how bacteria were able to fight viruses, because that is what the CRISPR system does in nature. We decided, okay, let's go for it. And later on, when I had to write my end report to NWO, I told them this. So I said, well, I am very grateful for the opportunity to be flexible, to just see where nature drives us, basically, where some results of other researchers drive us, and that's what we did. And so then we started to dig in to reveal the important features of the CRISPR-Cas system. And when we did find them, so when we found some basic principles, small RNAs being used to target DNA in a very specific way, and in a way that it's very easy, and that was unprecedented. If you compare it to other genome editing systems, you can very easily adjust the specificity, so the targeting. So meaning that basically you can use this system to target any gene in any organism that you want. And that's something we already figured out in 2008. Yeah. Then later on, other researchers built on this. For instance, people working on a different system with a fancy name, or well-known, I guess, for many people, that's Cas9, so CRISPR-Cas9. And in fact, the Nobel Prize was awarded to colleagues at other institutes that focused on that particular system. But in fact, we already figured out the important details back in 2008.
Right. And I should add that the what he calls the NWO, the National Science Foundation, is very much also with us when it comes to now making this step, and perhaps you can say this a few words, to make this intellectual property right available under license for, I should say, the application in plant breeding.
Right.
Yeah?
Yeah, so I mean, that was indeed in an STW project, so that's now part of NWO, and it was again a case of serendipity. We were looking for thermophilic bacteria, and for finding them, we went to a compost heap in Ede, so close by, and we went there on the bike. We took samples and we took them back, and we found some interesting bacteria, and we decided to sequence the entire genome, so the complete DNA content of these or a couple of selected bacteria, and in one of them we found a set of genes, one of which was what we now call the thermo-Cas9 enzyme.
Yeah, thank you. I should have added that John is our professor of microbiology, in case you hadn't discovered that. Nikita, please tell us who you are and why you think this is so relevant.
Well, thank you, Louise. It's really an honor to be here. My name is Nikita Sajiv, and I'm a PhD student in the Department of Plant Physiology here at Wageningen University. My research focuses on seed germination, so the step that plants take to ensure next generation. And specifically, I look at RNA-binding proteins, and these proteins help the seeds sense the environment so that they can make this very hard decision whether they should germinate or not. And this is a very hard decision because seeds need to understand, is there enough light, is there enough water, is the temperature just right so that the seedling will survive? And in my research, I use a lot of innovative tools to, you know, reveal the players in this decision-making. And I think CRISPR-Cas is one of these tools that can help fundamental research be applied at an accelerated, precise, and with relative ease. And I think it's really great that Wageningen University takes this initiative to open up this technology to people who need it the most, I would say, because we are here in a luxury position with a lot of options available to us, but in a lot of regions of the world, farmers are still struggling to grow basic crops. And the special part about CRISPR, I think, is also the fact that we can now modify plants in a way that they are genetically also similar to nature. It's not in all cases, but we can do that. We can make climate change resilient crops. We can also adapt or domesticate new crops that are actually more suited to the local environment. And I think this is also such a nice thing in the step of acceptance of this technology, because public perception is very important, and we shouldn't ignore that as well. And as a young scientist, I think we should make open and honest dialogue and communication a priority.
Right.
Yeah.
It's very good you highlight this. Yeah. So we're not talking, for those of you who don't have the number one volume of the Handbook of Genetics on their night tables, yeah, we're not talking about genetically modified organisms here. We're talking about a gene editing technique that in many cases, not always, can just lead to a plant which in many ways is not a genetically modified organism. So it's very important to stress this. Thank you for bringing that up. But as you said very well, this is also about making a difference.
Yes.
Now, I just turn to Max. Max Grandoon, this is really your field because, of course, science doesn't exist in isolation. It must be part and parcel of how society evolves. And public acceptance, as Nikita says, is extremely important. So what's your take on this? And also sort of introduce yourself with a few words, please.
Yeah, thank you, Louise, also for inviting me to this panel. I'm very honored to be here. I have a bit of a different background. I'm doing a PhD at the Agricultural Economics and Rural Policy Group, and I'm very happy that I'm doing a PhD on the bioeconomy, which is one of the solutions to climate change. And the bioeconomy is that part of the economy that is based on biological resources, so producing them and processing them. For example, you have agriculture or the pulp and paper sector. And well, what I learned during my research is that it's a very wide concept, a lot of different sectors, and all of them are related. So only having a small change in one area can have a big impact to all the different areas. This reminded me actually of the butterfly effect, which says that the flattening of a wing of a butterfly in one area can lead to a tornado in another area. And that's why when I heard about the announcement that you said, I think it can have a big impact, giving out these licenses in the whole bioeconomy, because these CRISPR-Cas applications, they can lead to a lot of developments in the plant breeding sector, which then again has an impact on agriculture. It can improve food security also under the changing climatic conditions. And then also in the bioeconomy, you have these non-food sectors, which also the CRISPR-Cas can improve the biomass input we use to produce sustainable bio-based products. And it can also increase the efficiency of biorefineries, which are basically an alternative to the oil refineries, and produce, for example, biofuels, biomaterials, and biochemicals.
And now, what would you see as the most logical or primary application of CRISPR-Cas from your perspective? Where do you see the greatest need?
I mean, I think the biggest impact can still be in agriculture and ensuring food security, especially in more developing countries. In Europe, it's maybe less of a problem. And then I think also the non-food use should not be, or the impact on the non-food sector should not be underestimated. We need to find alternatives to a lot of products that are based on fossil fuels at the moment. And also, for example, a biorefinery is competing at the moment with oil refineries, which have done research for a lot of time, more than 100 years. So they need to compete with that, and for that, anything that can improve the efficiency is very valuable.
Thank you. Nikita, just to return to your comment about the need to improve both existing crops, particularly, of course, in the global south, but also looking at new crops, or rather at traditional crops that are not yet subject to breeding in the way that, you know, the usual potato and rice are. Where do you see in this category of traditional crops, do you see any crops that would really show us some great advantages and great steps that can be taken thanks to CRISPR and CRISPR-related breeding?
Yeah, I think there have been so many examples where we, in research, find a gene that could really help improve drought resistance or improve any kind of traits that are controlled by multiple genes. And it's always been so hard to apply this fundamental knowledge into crops. And now we see that with CRISPR, it's much more easier, especially if you look at examples like wheat has been now. There have been genes that have been known to cause gluten allergies, and now with CRISPR, we can actually reduce the immunogenicity or the allergic response of gluten and help people to digest gluten and to have these wheat varieties better, for example, or maize that is also a bit more drought tolerant now. So a lot of major crops that were very hard to work with conventional breeding tools, now we can use CRISPR in a relatively easier way for major crops even.
And possibly also increase nutritional value, I would
think. Of course, especially for the developing countries. That's a really good point, yeah.
Yeah, iron content,
yes.
Protein content,
yes,
and so on.
Yes, of course.
Yeah. Yeah, thank you. John, if we gave you another, let's say, well, nobody from NWO is here in the room, I think, but let's dream and look a little bit beyond our boundaries. 100 million, what would you do with it?
Oh, well, that's very generous of you. that's a...
Well,
that's
okay, make it 50. We'll simplify your life?
That's a difficult question. I would have to think about that. But definitely, I mean, we have several research lines ongoing that could use the money for beautiful applications, but also to continue our journey to look at variations of the on the theme of the CRISPR theme, because also in nature boundaries are being crossed, and also in nature. I mean, you said that the human species is unique, and of course it is, but also, I mean, there are beautiful examples of what has been developed in the course of evolution. And one of the things that pops up right now is the huge diversity of different CRISPR systems, all with variations on different themes. And also that means that studying those, and that is what we are currently doing in the lab. We are about to submit another paper on yet another CRISPR subtype, because there are altogether 60, 70 different subtypes. We are about to release just another one, and with new features, with new possibilities, also for applications. And so the sky is the limit, and we are not done, so I'm afraid I need more money to really.
Okay, we'll go back
this.
To 100 million then. But seriously, where would your priority lie? Just looking at the broadness of all the CRISPRs, or going into depth for one or two and see whether you can tease even more out of them?
Well, both. So I mean, it's interesting to look for new variations, but it's also interesting to, for instance, use again the principles of evolution. So we call that laboratory evolution, to optimize certain of the natural enzymes. And one example was that I already mentioned the name Cas9. So when people started to look for possibilities to use that enzyme for gene therapy, then they found that there were too many mistakes being made by that enzyme. But then basically two approaches have resulted in very specific enzymes that do allow gene therapy. That's currently ongoing. One is that they basically looked at the diversity of natural evolution. So we now, and also Wageningen, my group was involved in the characterization of one of those alternatives called Cas12, and that was very, very specific. The other line was to use, again, the principles of evolution, but then in the lab, so laboratory evolution, to optimize Cas9. And that really has resulted in optimized versions of that enzyme. So it's both going looking around you what's there, but also digging deeper to
there's
optimize.
A horizon in the depth as well. Yeah. I'm always interested, but it's not something to discuss now, is why evolution has given us so many different pathways. There obviously is not one evolutionary principle at work here.
That's clear. That's the struggle for life.
Yeah, exactly.
It's our big hero, Darwin once said.
Yes, exactly.
And it's the continuous, in this case, the biological warfare, where the virus, for instance, and the bacterium, or the virus and the human being. I mean, we see that, we can read it in the newspaper, that there is yet another variation of the COVID virus. Well, that also happens with all organisms, because all cellular organisms they suffer from viral infection. So it's a continuous struggle, and that is why it resulted in a huge variety of different defense systems.
Exactly.
For instance.
Yeah, that's very interesting. Now, Max, turning back to you, for most people, a lot of what happens in genetics is not only complicated, but it also can be frightening. It seems, you know, as we might be playing with nature, or how do we get society to understand or to go this journey with us, to see that we need to make use of the advances of science in order to further some of the goals that you mentioned, to go to a bioeconomy, to get what Nikita said, to get drought-resistant plants with better nutritional value. How do we make that journey together with society?
Yeah, that's a good question and also a very hard question, I would say. I think also what you are doing, announcing this, giving out this patent for non-profit use, I think this is already a good start because it also sends a message, I think, to society. And it can maybe already improve the social acceptance. I think otherwise you need to be very clear that gene editing and GMOs are not the same. It's probably very clear for the scientists among us who are working on that, but the general public might be not know yet a lot about CRISPR or gene editing.
Yeah.
So I think you need to raise a lot of awareness.
I think that's a very important point. We have to reach out to the public.
Yeah.
So I mean, that's what I do. I go to science cafes. I yes. was asked to go to Lowlands, for instance, again. Unfortunately, the government didn't allow us to do that. And probably that was a good move. But I mean, reaching out to the public and trying to explain that basically what we buy in the supermarket, what we eat every day, that is. Or that the CRISPR food that we can now generate, that is at least as safe as what we buy every day and what we eat every day. And of course, I can state that, but I mean, we have to continue to reach out, to explain what's going on.
In my experience, the problem was not, I once gave a speech on GMO at Lowlands. That was not a problem with that generation. There is a problem maybe with a slightly elder generation. But basically what we're talking about here in the Western, sort of the Northern Hemisphere world, is of course the balancing of different goals. And people may want to have natural things and may not want to have too much genetic movement in what they eat, but it's very different in the global south. I think where really the question is, we have 2 billion people who do not have access to adequate food. Food needs to be affordable, it needs to be nutritious, it needs to be safe, and it needs to be sustainably produced. And that's where, and that's also the reason why we did this, that's why where we have the greatest gains to be made, and they have to be made very, very quickly. So Nikita, from your perspective, what would you advise us also as an institution? Do you see natural collaborators? Do you see people where we can combine, are giving out the licenses for free with the capacity building?
Yeah, I think it's very important that now, more than ever before, that we all work together, that we are open, we're honest, that we realize that for every unsustainable decision or choice that we make, there is a cost for our future, the generations to come, and that we have to be more responsible, we have to be more conscious about this. And I think taking this step is a first step, it needs to be followed up, and it we need to act now.
Right. Thank you.
Well, that's a very important point. It needs to be followed up. So we hope with this move at Wageningen University that also other patent owners, wherever they are on this globe, that they think about it and hopefully follow us.
We will work on them. Okay, I'm going to have to finalize the last words on this round table. Thank you so much for being with us and to give us your frank ideas, and of course to John, who's the motor behind everything. It's been a great pleasure, and I hope this conversation can be continued.
Yes.
We have a few more things to do on the podium here, so I'll let you go. So, before I give the floor to our rector to officially open the academic year, which is his prerogative, as you know, I do want to share another piece of a documentary with you, just to get us in the mood for what we've been talking about. This journey to cross boundaries, to look at chances, to look at coincidences, to look at the unexpected, and to really see the unexpected, those things that we usually don't see or don't want to see, or because we already think we know it, we are not open-minded enough. And open-mindedness in science and in art is a very important thing, and it means that you also have to be open-minded for all these coincidences. And the choice I've made is of a ballet which is really about serendipity. It's danced by the Dutch National Ballet, who, by the way, celebrate their 60th birthday this very week. And it is a choreography called What Brought You Here? Or What Got You Here, sorry. It's a choreography by Daniela Cardim. And it's based on a book that you may know, and if you don't know it, you should absolutely read it in this context. It's called A Short History of Everything by Bill Bryson, and some of you may know it. So here is our last piece of art to inspire you, because all of us, we have an artistic part in us as well as a scientific part. Here is the Dutch National Ballet, and after that, we'll have the official opening.
Welcome and congratulations. I'm delighted that you could make it. Getting here wasn't easy, I know. In fact, I suspect it was a little tougher than you realize. To begin with, for you to be here now, trillions of drifting atoms had somehow to assemble in an intricate and intriguingly obliging manner to create you. It's an arrangement so specialized and particular that it has never been tried before, and will only exist this once. For the next many years, we hope, these tiny particles will uncomplainingly engage in all the billions of deft cooperative efforts necessary to keep you intact, and let you experience the supremely agreeable but generally underappreciated state known as existence. But the fact that you have atoms, and that they assemble in such a willing manner, is only part of what got you here. To be here now, alive in the 21st century, and smart enough to know it, you also had to be the beneficiary of an extraordinary string of biological good fortune. Survival on Earth is a surprisingly tricky business. Of the billions and billions of species of living things that have existed since the dawn of time, most, 99.99%, are no longer around. Life on Earth, you see, is not only brief, but dismayingly tenuous. Not only have you been lucky enough to be attached since time immemorial to a favored evolutionary line, but you have also been extremely, make that miraculously, fortunate in your personal ancestry. Consider the fact that for 3.8 billion years, a period of time older than the Earth's mountains and rivers and oceans, every one of your forebears, on both sides, has been attractive enough to find a mate, healthy enough to reproduce, and sufficiently blessed by fate and circumstances to live long enough to do so. Not one of your pertinent ancestors was squashed, devoured, drowned, starved, stuck fast, untimely wounded, or otherwise deflected from its life's quest of delivering a tiny charge of genetic material to the right partner at the right moment in order to perpetuate the only possible sequence of hereditary combinations that could result, eventually, astoundingly, and all too briefly, in you. Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, if we dwell on the theme of crossing boundaries, we cannot but also mention at least three of the members of our community. Three members who cross really boundaries, not so much between arts and science, but definitely between sports and science. And of course, I'm referring to the three medal winners of the Olympic Games. Frederik Matla, who won a gold medal with a hockey team. Femke Bol, who won a bronze medal on the 400 meter hurdles. And Emma Oosterweger, who won a bronze medal on the heptathlon. I think it's great what they did during their studies, being an active student, but also being really a prize winner. Last year, when we also were in this auditorium, we were also facing Corona. We mentioned already that we were facing a difficult time. And of course, we hoped by that time we were at the end of that difficult time. But it cost us another year of Corona. It was not an easy year, I can guarantee you that. And of course, you know that. You have all experienced that. Regardless of those difficulties, I think we performed very well as an organization. We've performed well in science. We performed very well in education, staff both as well as students. And we performed also well in all our societal duties, which we do in outreaching to society. And the executive board and also the general directors of the science group really want to thank all members of our community, staff as well as students, for their commitment of the past year to science and education, to their flexibility, but also especially for looking after each other in this year. Fortunately, we are, at least we hope, are getting to a more normal situation. Education and science is a little bit back to normal. We can have at least education with 75 persons in a room. We can do more on campus, but we also know that it will not be a linear trajectory. It will not only be uphill. I think the Scientific Council of Governmental Policy, the WRR, already said that quite wisely in five scenarios which they produced last week. We have some comfort in the fact that we just found out that almost 95% of our students are vaccinated or on their way to vaccination, and that also counts for our staff. And that gives us a lot of confidence on what's happening. And we see also that other universities are following our path and also doing a similar kind of investigation to see if they also can have this comfort of large groups of students which are really vaccinated or on the way to vaccinations. It's also good to know that the government also supports us with extra funds for compensating those who lost some time doing research, to help also education to be back on track. And we know also that Corona will give us a lot of difficulties in finding a new balance between working at home and working on campus. And we will do that, in, of course, with our strategic housing plan, which is now being discussed and developed in our community, very much via a bottom-up process, where we hear what all kinds of staff members and students think about working at home versus working on campus. So these are some of the things we can expect the coming year. But we also know that we are continue to live in a very volatile world, both nationally as well as internationally. Think only about what the new government will bring, if it will ever bring something, but that's a joke, of course. We know that there are tremendous crises going on and still ahead of us. Climate change, nitrogen, sustainability writ large, of course, the digital society, which will be there, preventive health, which will help us probably in the Corona pandemic. All these things are very at the heart of our organization, and we will work on that on the coming year. But we also know, in order to work on that, we need more funding for that. And we also make the claim as the Commons universities, together also with other science organizations, among which the Royal Academy of Arts and Sciences, towards the government to really help us in doing, being able to do more research on those pressing challenges in society. Now we're getting close to the opening of the academic year, which basically already, of course, happened in Wageningen last Monday. We can also mention that we did that opening also with a new education building, Aurora. And Aurora is, of course, the goddess of dawn, at least it refers to that, which, as you know, probably was the daughter of the sun god Sol. And Aurora stands for really dawn, lightning, and this very light building. It opens up, it gives space to students to study, for teachers to really educate those students. And we will also see in the coming year, a new building being finalized. What we now call, up until now, called the Dialogue Center, but where we can now also say what will be the final name, and that will be Omnia, which means in Latin everything or all. Of course, all you have heard enough about just a few minutes ago. So that means also that this will be the last time that we will have the opening of our academic year here in this auditorium. And of course, that gives some reasons for sadness, but we really look forward to this new building, Omnia, where we can have not only these kind of openings and inaugural addresses and defenses of PhDs, but also, of course, especially the dialogue with society. And what, of course, we will also be looking forward to in the coming year is the update of the strategic plan, which we are at the moment finalizing in close discussion and collaboration with the wide community of Wageningen University and Research, where we at least explore three new strategic investment themes where we will focus upon. Most likely, biodiversity will be a part of that. Of course, the bioeconomy, which we just heard about, that will be part of that, and also looking further into the data sciences. One thing we know for sure for the new academic year, that we will again see motivated students and staff working on the big challenges of today and wanted to excel and have an impact. We have done that in the past year under difficult circumstances, and we will continue to do that for also the new year. And with that, ladies and gentlemen, I want to officially open the academic year, of course, on behalf of the Executive Board and the General Directors of the Science Group, and doing that, of course, in retrospect, because we already started that, but nevertheless declare that new academic year open and invite you all, at least that is those who are present in this auditorium, to have a final drink in Hotel the Wereld. Thank you very much.